Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Get the Meeting, an Illustrative Contact Marketing Playbook by Stu Heinecke. Narrated by Jonathan Yen. Publisher's Note: The print and ebook formats of this book include illustrations and visuals not present in the audio edition. Divide $200,000 by the cost of a cupcake, then multiply by 100. I get 5,000,000% ROI. Foreword. The first thing I did after reading Get the Meeting was walk it down to my sales team. It's that good. It's that important. It's an easy listen that will spur you to consider the value of contact marketing, replete with examples including a new replacement for business cards, pocket campaigns, plus forward-looking practices and real-world uses of video, social media, visual metaphors, gifts, digital marketing, artificial intelligence, augmented reality, virtual reality, and more. All in the service of getting important meetings. If Phil Kotler is the father of marketing, Stu is the father of contact marketing. He coined the very phrase in his first book, How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, while applying a lifetime of success stories that gird his mastery. In this book, Stu makes a freshly compelling case for approaching contact marketing as a strategic asset for anyone looking to rapidly expand the scale of their network, and thus their careers, businesses, and lives. As Stu is fond of saying, one meeting can change everything. But you cannot innovate without creativity. You cannot be creative without imagination. You cannot imagine without inspiration. And that is precisely how Stu's new playbook on contact marketing fills the gap. It will be an inspiration to anyone who feels stymied by the increasing difficulty of reaching decision makers in every sector of commerce, and really, in life as a whole. Because we all need to get meetings. Whether you're a sales development rep, a CEO, or somewhere in between, nothing happens without contact with the right people. Few topics receive more attention in the field of marketing than the notion of friction-free experience design. Stu rightly points out that in the B2B world, gaining access is the number one source of friction today. And who better to write a book like Get the Meeting than Stu himself? He's not only an author and marketer, he is a Wall Street Journal cartoonist. That killer combination led him on a journey, first to discover the magical effect of cartoons as contact devices, and then to discover this mysterious, shadowy form of marketing, something that has been quietly used for years to make critically important connections happen, often with explosive results. But I must warn you, as a level-headed business person, you may find what Stu shares in this book rather shocking, perhaps even upsetting. You will hear about metrics that should be impossible. When he asserts that the new baseline for response to a contact marketing should now be 100%, you're probably going to find it hard to believe. And when you hear that the new ROI record for a contact marketing campaign has reached into the millions of percent, your head will spin. And it ought to. This isn't another unoriginal book the world didn't need about sales or marketing or business. It's a shocking call to up your game by orders of magnitude. But it is also a practical guide to show you how to do it all, step by step. One could argue the most meaningful point in a customer journey is the first contact. After listening to this book and fully implementing the contact marketing model within, I think you'll agree with Stu. One meeting really can change everything. Russ Klein, CEO, the American Marketing Association. Introduction. If you've ever seen the movie Hitch, you've seen contact marketing in action. 33 minutes and 13 seconds into the 2005 feature film, a secretive matchmaking consultant named Hitch, played by Will Smith, sends a contact device to reporter Sarah Milas, played by Ava Mendez. A courier walks into her office and hands her a box. As Sarah signs for it, her curiosity steadily rises. What is this and who sent it? She wonders as she hands the pen and manifest back to the courier. Sarah excitedly opens the box and finds something surprising inside. A walkie-talkie. It's already turned on. She picks it up. Hello? Hitch is on the other end, waiting to engage. His mission? To persuade Sarah to go on a date with him. While the ultimate aim of Hitch's contact marketing piece wasn't to sell something, it did have a meeting as its intent, and it's easy to see how a tactic like the walkie-talkie in a box could work for just about anyone trying to gain the attention of an important account or prospect. If you read my debut book, How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, ploys like Hitch sending a walkie-talkie in a box sound familiar. You may recall Dan Waldschmidt's sending of swords to break through to CEOs of distressed companies. Rick Bennett's contact letter run as a full-page ad in the Wall Street Journal. And No Wait's brilliant personalized videos delivered on iPads. Not to mention the pigeon used to arrange lunch and a $250,000 deal with one of the most famous CEOs in the world. You may also remember the story I tell in the book of my own experience with using cartoons in a contact campaign to connect with just 24 vice presidents and directors of circulation at the biggest publishing houses in New York. It was a campaign that produced a 100% contact rate and a 100% conversion to sale rate and launched my business. It was worth millions of dollars to me, and it all came from a campaign that cost less than $100. So, you might wonder, how is this book different from the original? What does it add to the contact marketing story? The first book has resonated with people all over the world who really needed to get meetings. Naturally, those who sell for a living see the value in breaking through to virtually anyone immediately. But there are also entrepreneurs who recognize that the ability to make critical connections quickly is essential to their success, and nonprofits that perceive the significance of making contact with more mega donors. Job seekers, too, understand the unfair advantage it gives them to stand out to prospective employers. I know, because a lot of those people shared their stories with me. But they also unanimously expressed one unfulfilled wish after reading How to Get a Meeting with Anyone. They wanted to see what the campaigns looked like. What did it look like when Dan Waldschmidt sent those swords? What does it look like when I send cartoons to help enterprise sales teams break through to their top accounts and prospects? Those are important questions, and I sought to address them in this book. The intent was to produce a collection of case studies with photography to give people a better look at successful contact campaigns. But the book quickly took on a bigger scope. The change happened as I was Googling the coolest business cards in the world. I discovered there was a collection of the same cards showing up over and over. There was Kevin Mitnick's lockpick card, made of etched stainless steel, and Remo Camanida's card sleeve combination for a dentist that was so involving it was easy to see why the card regularly generates new business for the doctor. Then there was Paul Nielsen's sheet rubber card that changed everything. It suggested an entirely new paradigm for the results we should expect from our contact marketing campaigns, which already reach as high as 100%. I'll just say, it can go even higher. These and other cards in the compilations all had one thing in common. They didn't follow the strategy that defines every business card on the planet. And they suggested an even more radical strategy that has business cards directly generating sales, revenue, metrics, and ROI. I have dubbed these pocket campaigns in this book. Then I started looking at the roles technologies, such as artificial intelligence, augmented reality, AR, and virtual reality, VR, might play in future campaigns. And again, an astonishing new paradigm emerged. The more I looked, the more the book transformed from a collection of case studies to an entirely new playbook for contact marketing, even a new manifesto for what contact marketing should become. Some of the insights into how much contact marketing has evolved and how profoundly it can contribute to rapid, sustainable growth didn't even occur to me until I reviewed all the chapters together. What emerged was a shocking set of conclusions, which combine at the end of the book, where I describe the perfect contact campaign, a step-by-step guide for your own campaign. This isn't all theory and no practice. There are still plenty of case studies of even more audacious things people have done to break through to their most important prospects and accounts. They're amazing, and now fully illustrated with photography and art. There is a lot to see and reference for your own campaigns. How to get a meeting with anyone includes 20 categories of contact marketing campaigns. They are all still valid, and all still generating strong results. This book shows a few of the campaigns described in the first, but most of it is new. You'll find new sections on AI, AR, and VR, LinkedIn, personalization, digital marketing, jewel boxing, unsolicited proposals, perseverance, video, and the aforementioned pocket campaigns. They are all additive to my seminal book. There is also a fascinating look into how Hollywood has either portrayed contact marketing in film or used contact marketing directly to arrange Tinseltown tete-a-tetes. One story in particular about a young singer-songwriter gaining the attention of Johnny Cash will utterly inspire you. That story alone confirms the expression, "Fortune favors the bold," so completely that you will never again doubt the value of audacity in your own client outreach. When Amazon first announced it would be seeking a location for a second headquarters, cities, states, and municipalities were invited to submit proposals. The company received more than 250 submissions, but some contenders went much further, turning Amazon's HQ2 search into one of the biggest contact marketing stories in recent history. Tucson sent Amazon a 21-foot-tall saguaro cactus. The city of Stonecrest, Georgia, offered to change its name to Amazon. Another set up giant Amazon packages all over the city, with wireless devices to issue tweets to the company about the benefits of locating its new headquarters there. We all know how the Amazon story turned out, but the big message is that contact marketing has grown, and that is the focus of this second book in the series. Even though it produces response rates and ROI figures well beyond those of other forms of marketing, we are still only beginning to see how far it can go. Contact marketing is expanding and evolving rapidly. It is also quickly becoming mainstream, as it proves its worth as a sales growth strategy. I was expecting to write a book about case studies, but it turned into something much more. It turned into an entirely new model for contact marketing, one in which we expect to regularly generate 100% response rates, support the impetus for any given sale all the way through completion, and provoke more sales from existing clients. We live in an amazing age, one in which we can connect on LinkedIn with the authors of our favorite books, ask questions, and share stories. I've heard some amazing ones from the readers of How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, particularly about the difference that book has made in their careers and lives. In the later paperback edition, I included the story of how Dom Steinman used contact marketing to leapfrog from a freshly hired sales development representative, SDR, just out of college, to sales manager of a multi-billion dollar company in the span of just 1 year. Since then, other stories about startups using the book to quickly spool up have poured in. Some readers keep piles of the book on hand to give out as gifts. Others use it as a training manual for their sales teams. What is clear is that contact marketing is an important tool for sales, business development, job searching, really any activity that requires contact with the key people with the power to change everything, if only they could be reached. Contact marketing gives us that ability. And as you're about to hear in the coming chapters, it has evolved into a miraculous tool for exploding the scale of our careers, businesses, and lives. Let's jump in, shall we? Part 1. Contact Marketing Basics. Chapter 1. Making Contact. What is the greatest friction point in every career and in every business? It's not the absence of customers or investors. It's not resistance from a hyper-competitive market. It's not a shortage of capital. It is the lack of access to important people. It's getting meetings, the right meetings, with the people who can become dream clients, sponsors, strategic partners, employers, or investors. With the people who have the power to change everything. Amazing things could happen if only you could get through. If you had the ability to get meetings with anyone, at will, all the friction-causing issues before would disappear. You'd have access to customers, investors, and an abundance of revenue. You'd slice through competitors. And you'd have all the capital you want. Or you'd get that job interview with that dream employer. Doesn't that sound like a skill worth having? The ability to make contact is a universal human need and challenge. Everything we do in life requires making connections. As a marketer, I need to make connections, and I have had tremendous success in doing so. You see, I have a secret weapon that gets people's attention. Among other things, I'm a cartoonist for the Wall Street Journal. Being able to craft cartoons as a device to make connections is a great advantage. I've used them to reach presidents, prime ministers, celebrities, countless CEOs, and other top decision makers. It has always been easy for me to break through. I used to think my cartoon drawing talents gave me an unfair advantage, but I was wrong. Well, partially wrong. It is an advantage to use a creative approach in making contact with someone, but you don't have to be a professional cartoonist to be a successful contact marketer. For my first book, How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, I interviewed the top 100 sales thought leaders in the world and asked them how they were breaking through to their top-level connections. If you've read that book, you'll know that they had some of their own brilliant, creative ways to do so. I later discovered that every time I spoke to a group and asked if someone had a can't-miss method for breaking through, there were always hands raised. As I interviewed sources for that first book, I also learned that no one had a name for what we were doing, using inventive, audacious means to connect. It's surprising that something so commonly used wouldn't have a name. So I gave it one: contact marketing. And ever since, the term has been catching on all over the world. I'll provide a more elaborate definition later in this chapter, but briefly, contact marketing is a disciplined ability to make contact with our most important prospects, investors, partners, mentors, and others. 100% response rate as your baseline. My first experience with contact marketing came at the start of my career. I wanted to create direct mail campaigns for the big magazine publishers, and I quickly picked up assignments from Rolling Stone and Bon Appetit. The mailings both featured cartoons with personalized captions, so even my first contact campaign used personalized cartoons. Those first test campaigns for the two magazines set new response records, and I wanted to share the story with the rest of the big publishers. That meant connecting with about 24 highly placed contacts at Time Incorporated, Condé Nast, Forbes, The Wall Street Journal, Times Mirror magazines, and more. The campaign included an 8x10 frameable personalized cartoon print and a letter explaining the approach and new results. I suggested that we use the same device in tests for their titles. The campaign generated a 100% response. I connected with all the target executives, and they all became clients. That's a 100% contact rate and a 100% conversion. It is the campaign that launched my business. It was worth millions of dollars, and it stemmed from a campaign spend of less than $100. What I just described to you is supposed to be impossible. No one gets 100% response rates to any form of marketing. Many are content with just a few percentage points. And while some campaigns score higher, many digital forms eke out tiny fractions of a percentage point for response. Similarly, marketing campaigns are meant to produce at least as much as was spent. If they get multiples of 100%, management is pretty happy. But contact marketing campaigns regularly produce returns on investment, ROI, of over 10,000%, or even well over 100,000. In my research, I've found that the record percentage return for a contact marketing campaign is in the tens of millions. In ads for How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, the headline reads, "One meeting can change everything." It most certainly can. When I think back on all the best things that have happened in my life, they involve, first, making extraordinary connections with people in extraordinary positions. I met my wife after spotting her in a magazine. Obviously, we wouldn't have gotten married if I were not able to meet her. Every one of the major accounts in my contact marketing agency came as a result of making extraordinary connections. This book exists because of remarkable connections. My cartoons appear in the Wall Street Journal because of life-changing editorial connections. All the interviews that informed my books came from making important connections. I am sure if you think about each milestone in your life, you'll have a similar story. They all come from making remarkable connections. Thus, this could be one of the most important books you could ever listen to advance your career, your business, and your life. Putting it all together, Contact Marketing 101. This book is part of a series that began with How to Get a Meeting with Anyone. The two books are different in scope, and if you haven't read the first in the series, you'll probably want to pick it up to read about the many strategies, stories, and tools I include there, and learn about the 20 categories of contact marketing campaigns that are not part of this book. The intent of both books is to empower you to make any connections you want with anyone you choose. To do so, you need to know some basics about contact marketing and connecting with important people at will. These basics include the definition of contact marketing, the notion of executive assistance as your ally, the ability to develop a VIP statement, the idea of going after the CEO, the center of enterprise opportunity, and the fundamentals of a million-dollar phone call. I cover those in depth in How to Get a Meeting with Anyone, but here is a look at those concepts briefly. Contact marketing, a fusion of marketing and selling in which often audacious forms of marketing are used in support of specific high-level sales approaches to VIP prospects and accounts, resulting in extraordinarily high levels of response, ROI, and explosive growth of the enterprise. Executive assistants are your ally. Most sales reps refer to executive assistants as gatekeepers and wonder how they can circumvent them to get to the executive. Ironically, that attitude is what prevents them from breaking through. Assistants meter access, but their job is also to bring relevant sources and people to their boss's attention. They are always watching for interesting opportunities their executives might otherwise miss. Think of executive assistants as vice presidents of access or talent scouts. They wield tremendous power and are some of the sharpest people in their organizations. Your job is to package yourself as someone who belongs and is welcomed. Assistants should be part of your campaign. Include a few contact elements just for them. Remember also that executives rely on their assistant's judgment of callers. They'll ask how the caller treated the assistant. They'll ask the assistant's opinion of the caller. Assistants often have the power to say, "You need to talk to this person." Engineer your contact campaign to ensure executive assistants always become your allies. Develop a VIP statement. When you first break through to a target executive or their assistant, you have only a few seconds to entice them. That's when you should be ready to deliver your VIP statement. Try to confine it to a dozen words or fewer. Ultimately, as Shift co-author Craig Elias says, it should contain a bold promise that has them asking, "How would you do that?" My VIP statement is a bit different. I often send a cartoon to connect. Before sending, I contact the executive assistant and say this: "Hello, my name is Stu Heinecke. I'm one of the Wall Street Journal's cartoonists, and I'm sending a print of one of my cartoons about your boss." It's almost an ambush. Who wouldn't want to continue the conversation? You must come up with your own quick statement of introduction that does not allow the prospect or assistant to dismiss your call. The goals have changed. Every campaign must define the desired response it will produce. In contact marketing, we want recipients to respond, "I love the way you think." But as you will come to understand, the mission has changed a bit. Now we're looking to incite evangelism with our campaigns. Now the desired response is, "Wow, hey, everyone, come here. You've got to see this." They're still impressed with your thinking, but now we want to motivate recipients to share your campaign with colleagues. CEO, Center of Enterprise Opportunity. It's nice to connect with actual CEOs, that is, chief executive officers, but there are many times when it's unnecessary. As Eat Their Lunch author Anthony Innerino explains, you want to reach the CEO of the problem you want to solve. Imagine CEO to mean Center of Enterprise Opportunity, and target the person who really has the authority and acute need to do business with you. It will make your campaign far more effective. Your million-dollar phone call. When you get the right person on the phone or in a meeting, you should always be aware not only of what you want, but how to get it. That means always being ready to make a million-dollar phone call. If someone asks you, "How could we do $1 million worth of business right now?" you ought to be ready to answer. If you wanted to do $1 million program with my agency, I already know what the structure, pace, scale, and expected results would be. You should be similarly prepared for your prospecting calls. Critical next steps. For each chapter of this book, you will find an objective related to the chapter, along with a set of critical steps to follow and important questions to ask yourself, based on the types of contact campaign ideas presented in the chapter. Use these steps and questions to form your new transformative strategy. Take time to record your answers. Your notes will guide your contact marketing strategy. By the end of the book, you will have everything you need to press ahead, connect with anyone, and grow your business. Objective: adapt your approach to make the connections you desire. Step 1. Ask yourself, what do I want to change? Chances are you bought this book because there is something about how you do business, or even how you do life, you want to change. That is, you want the outcome to change. If making contact is the biggest friction point in business, what is your commitment to changing that source of friction in yours? Keep in mind, contact marketing is more than a collection of clever tactics for connecting. It is a change management program meant to create rapid growth, greater market share, and unfair strategic advantages. So, what do you want to change? Step 2. Take stock. What have you tried so far? We all have experience with reaching out to people who are important to our lives. What have you been doing so far, and how has it been working? Are there elements that are unique to you that should be integrated into your future approaches? What hasn't worked, and why? Step 3. Confront what you like least about prospecting. When you think of cold calling, what thoughts immediately come to mind? Is prospecting your least favorite business activity, thus something you avoid? If it is, give thought to what may be holding you back. The contact marketing strategies in this book will help you break through, but first, you've got to get past your own mental blockades. Points to remember. Making contact is the biggest friction point in business. The ability to break through to those most important to our success is a universal human need. The purpose of contact marketing is to give you an unfair advantage in your marketplace. Contact marketing is actually a change management initiative that drives the enterprise toward rapid growth and market dominance. Contact marketing produces unusually high levels of response and ROI, well beyond any other form of marketing. Contact marketing is a fusion of marketing and selling. Combining the two disciplines results in an unusual level of cooperation and shared objectives for the greater good of the enterprise. Contact marketing is the name I gave to the practice of using audacious, clever means to connect with important contacts. This book does not replace How to Get a Meeting with Anyone. The first book explains contact marketing in depth and contains strategies and 20 categories of contact marketing campaigns that are not in this book. Each complements the other. Be sure to record your answers and observations for each step listed in the Critical Next Steps section at the end of each chapter. By the end of the book, your notes will define your contact marketing strategy. Remember, one meeting really can change everything. Chapter 2: The Power of Perseverance. Two words float in our vocabularies, often interchangeably, that are often uttered with a tone of admiration, unless they're used to describe the actions of salespeople: perseverance and persistence. If entrepreneurs persevere over several years to launch a business and then sell it for hundreds of millions of dollars, they're heroes. If a saleswoman persists through 97 calls and finally makes an appointment on the 98th, she's a pest. Yet both have produced, through their perseverance, enormous value from their efforts. In this section, we'll explore the nature and meaning of these two words in the context of making good things happen in business. We'll examine amazing stories of success produced through sheer determination, and we'll look at how persistence and perseverance can be systematized in your own business activities. But first, let's look at the difference between the two words. The dictionary defines perseverance as steady persistence in a course of action, purpose, or state, especially in spite of difficulties, obstacles, or discouragement. It's interesting that perseverance is actually defined by the display of persistence. Meanwhile, persistence is defined simply as the act of persisting, the quality of being persistent. Both words are defined with the word persistence, but the word perseverance shows up in neither definition. So, what's going on here? We know that a cough can persist, but it doesn't persevere. A noxious odor can persist, an annoying noise can persist, but they're never described as persevering. Persistence is the simple act of continuing relentlessly. Perseverance requires awareness, intent, and character. Persistence is the act of repeated action. Perseverance is a character trait. Perseverance is the strategic driver of why we persist. When we persevere, we use persistence to make it happen. Perseverance is often said to make the difference between success and failure. There are many stories of deals achieved in which persistence alone was the driving force. It tells the buyer you're for real. It shows them how interested you are, how consistent the quality of your work is, and how you handle adverse conditions. It provides a preview of the relationship ahead. It gives assurance that you'll always be there when needed. And that can greatly improve your odds for a successful outcome in your contact marketing campaigns. Perseverance brings breakthroughs. To research this chapter, I returned to the top sales thought leaders in the world who were the original sources for How to Get a Meeting with Anyone. For that book, I asked, when you absolutely must connect with someone important, someone nearly impossible to reach, how do you do it? This time I asked, what is the nature and value of perseverance in sales and in business? And once again, they shared superb insights and techniques. The group's unanimous conclusion is that perseverance is a required trait for success in business and certainly in sales. They all have stories of people who have persevered through daunting circumstances, emerging with great rewards on the other side. New Sales Simplified author Mike Weinberg can trace the acquisition of his present home to one account in particular that he won as a result of relentless perseverance. The famed Hollywood movie producer Brian Grazer, whom we'll revisit in Chapter 3, is an expert at getting meetings with literally anyone. He is an obsessively curious man, which fuels the consistently excellent quality of the films he and partner Ron Howard produce for our enjoyment. How does he satisfy that relentless curiosity? He seeks out fascinating people for meetings, or what he calls curiosity conversations. Over the course of his career, Grazer has met with Jonas Salk, the man who saved millions of lives by discovering a cure for polio, Jim Lovell, Apollo 13 astronaut, Edward Teller, inventor of the hydrogen bomb, and Fidel Castro, as well as countless artists, musicians, scientists, entrepreneurs, politicians, journalists, and philanthropists. It must be nice to be an Oscar-winning Hollywood producer, but the secret to Grazer's success at getting meetings doesn't stem from his fame. He attributes his success to one thing: perseverance. In his book, A Curious Mind, co-authored with Charles Fishman, he tells fantastic stories of perseverance. In one case, Grazer left messages for a year before breaking through for a meeting. Even in his vaunted position, perseverance is a must. It turns out, Grazer is just like the rest of us. If perseverance is necessary for our selling success, can it be taught? Can it be reduced to a process? Our experts were split on this question. High-profit prospecting author Mark Hunter believes it is imperative to hire someone for whom perseverance is already a native trait. In fact, he advises clients to put new sales rep candidates to the test. At the conclusion of the first interview, the hiring manager promises to call back in 2 days, but never does. It's only after the prospective rep calls back a second time that they reconnect for a second interview. If the candidate doesn't pass that simple test, they never get hired. Does this mean all is lost if you weren't born with a knack for perseverance? Perseverance is a character trait, not a personality trait, which means it can be developed. And like any character trait, it takes desire and discipline and lots of practice. As Hunter's example shows, those who have developed perseverance already have a big advantage, but it can be cultivated in anyone. As you'll hear in some of this chapter's case studies, some sales reps discovered simple techniques that can smooth the way and help anyone become more persistent. It begins with following a plan. Make an appointment with yourself first. Many of us miss the simplest point about being persistent. We move through our days, perhaps making lists of what we want to accomplish. We think we're being efficient, but mostly we're just busy missing the mark. In a rush to check off as many items as possible, we attack the easy things first. Order a copy of that report. Check. Make sure the invitations to that event were sent. Check. Call IT to change a password. Check. Order those shoes from Amazon. Check. But at the end of the day, that critical deal outline is still left unfinished. In fact, not even started. There's always time tomorrow. Meanwhile, unexpected client needs intervene all day long. It's pretty easy to be busy all day and never notice you got very little done. That is especially true of the things you perhaps didn't want to do in the first place, like following up on sales outreach. As Your Sales Management Guru's Guide series author and Forbes contributor Ken Thorson points out, people don't like to do things they don't want to do. His advice is to do the hard things on the list first, but also to set up appointments with yourself throughout the week for prospecting and follow-up. Persistence needs to be a priority. So, how do we persevere in giving persistence the place it deserves? It needs to show up in our calendars. Tactical example: putting persistence in your calendar. Tactic: be strategic with your time and leads by creating a persistence campaign. Background: there are many stories of deals achieved in which persistence alone is the driving force. New sales simplified Author Mike Weinberg points out that most salespeople try once or twice on a sale and then give up. Challenges. It makes sense that if you don't book time in your calendar for follow-up, it won't get done. It certainly won't get the attention it deserves, and continually failing to follow up is what causes requests for contact and sales to fail. Campaign specifics. A persistence campaign has two requirements: a defined process for follow-up that maps out the touches, tools, and scripts to be used over the course of a scheduled set of steps, and a disciplined use of time to ensure the process is followed. What does this look like? First, you build follow-up time into your schedule. Simply carving out daily 2-hour blocks in your calendar 6 weeks in advance helps you corral the inevitable day-to-day interruptions that monopolize the most productive uses of your time. Why it's needed. We keep hearing it takes 7 to 12 touches before a buyer responds. The logical conclusion is that setting up time for regular follow-ups immediately raises the likelihood that your contact marketing outreach will be successful. But if you don't book time in your calendar for follow-up, it won't get done. What to keep in mind. Admittedly, just inserting regular appointments in your calendar to be persistent sounds like a simplistic solution. But remember that perseverance is a pattern, a product of time and discipline, and a lot of people simply never get around to it. If you constantly find yourself working down a daily to-do list, being very busy, but seldom accomplishing your goals, setting firm appointments on your calendar is an easy solution. Timing, discipline, and mindset. Perseverance is important for anyone in business. For the entrepreneur, perseverance drives the vision forward, attracts investors, and fills the client roster. For the manager, it powers their rise through the ranks as successes mount. For the business owner, it is the difference between a flourishing enterprise with exit strategy potential and a bankrupt flop. But for the sales rep, perseverance is even more serious. In the daily sink-or-swim reality of their careers, they must be naturally persistent or drown in a series of missed quotas until they're finally fired. This is not just a heartless push by management to produce sales. It's the central mission of the company: profit or perish. Perseverance is more than a personality trait. It is also a mindset, a mental toughness merged with an unyielding confidence that the solution you're offering will substantially improve the client's business. Hacking Sales author Max Altshuler says it's best to adopt an immigrant's point of view. Many grew up in tough circumstances and learned to fight and persevere to get what they wanted. And they employ that mindset throughout their lives, often giving them an unbeatable advantage over native citizens who've had it too easy and lack resilience in the face of disappointment. But you don't have to come from a third world country to create an unbeatable advantage in the perseverance race. High Profit Selling author Mark Hunter reminds us that there is always a reset button. If today was tough, hit the reset button and come in refreshed the next day, ready to make amazing things happen. He says one key is to make the process fun. But wait, how do you make the process of beating your head against the wall every day fun? As a first step, stop seeing it as beating your head against the wall. Then you can build a process to follow that actually is fun because it works. Case study. RAM Tools Persistence Process. Background. Sales expert Mike Weinberg tells an inspiring story about RAM Tool, a company that sells construction supplies. RAM Tool faces stiff opposition in its markets from entrenched competitors with long-standing relationships with the major contractors in their areas. Challenges. Relationships are built over time. Ram's sales reps wouldn't stand a chance of breaking through by calling on their construction accounts offices. They needed to be out on the job sites, meeting with the foremen who make purchasing decisions as needs arise. Campaign specifics. Every working day, Ram tool reps head out to construction sites in their territories, clad in visibility vests, work boots, and construction helmets. They're there to run their process, a prescribed 10-step persistence campaign that consistently wins new business. The campaign is a series of weekly visits to the job superintendent, each time delivering a little more value, asking a few planned questions. The reps are courteous, always respect the foreman's time, and always end each encounter with a promise to show up again in a week. Results. For Ram Tool, perseverance isn't some loose concept of never giving up in the face of adversity, of never saying no. It is a well-defined 10-wave campaign that produces consistent, predictable outcomes. Note that this is not a sales automation operation. It is a process of personally showing up, of demonstrating commitment to the buyer's success. Ram Tool reports its 10-wave campaign produces a roughly 80% conversion. The campaign generates business based on programmed perseverance. Each rep uses the same process and gets roughly the same outcome. By the 10th week, Ram Tool's prospects often remark, "It seems like you're really serious. Let's take a look at a few things we need." That is a direct result of perseverance and the commitment it demonstrates to the buyer. Perseverance wins business. Key takeaway. Perseverance can show up as a natural course of events driven by the rep's push to develop business. Perhaps there is a natural cadence to their outreach and follow-up actions. It could be a demonstration of the rep's mindset, sense of timing, and discipline. But as Ram Tool's campaign shows, persistence can easily be translated into a program that produces uniform follow-up and results. Your contact campaign should be built around that same personal persistence. Since our contact marketing mission is to break through and do it in a way that has the target executive saying, "I love the way you think," a demonstration of tenacity and commitment can be a powerful contributing factor to your success. Value over time. To persist is to contact over and over and over. That can either lead to a lot of frustration on both sides or a successful outcome. Some sales reps wonder why they're not breaking through. They send a lot of emails and follow up regularly, but still receive no response from the contact. Others build contact over time, which leads to relationships and trust, and ultimately to sales. The same apparent level of work is producing very different levels of business. What's causing the difference? In most cases, it is a matter of delivering cumulative value. But let's pause for a moment. Isn't the goal of contact marketing to help you break through to your toughest prospects on the first try? Well, yes, it is. It's far less work and a greatly shortened sales cycle if you can get in and start selling right away. But whether you make immediate contact or it takes several efforts to make the connection, perseverance sets the stage and plays a central role in moving the contact forward. One of the best ways of making that happen is to continually deliver value. It shows that you care about the contact target's business, and it models the kind of relationship you'll have before they commit to any business with you. Most executives treasure insights and information they can't get anywhere else. If you become the source of that value, you earn the status of trusted business advisor, a necessary step toward capturing scale-bursting levels of business. How to deliver value. How can you deliver value? Three sales veterans and authors weigh in with three steps you can take to provide value to prospective clients. These actions give you valuable content to use in a persistence campaign. Be a fountain of information. Tibor Shanto, author of the Objection Handling Handbook, says delivering value can be as simple as sending articles from publications the executive might not otherwise see that touch in some way upon issues in their markets and industries. Articles should always be sent with a quick narrative explaining the relevance of the piece to their business. Be on even footing in terms of knowledge. Your Sales Management Guru's Guide series author, Ken Thorson, recommends reading voraciously to create equal business status with targeted executives. Start an advisory board. Thorson also advocates convening a customer advisory group, a set of executives from 8 of your clients, to discuss challenges, trends, and problems they're seeing in their marketplaces. Channel your inner news reporter. Tom Searcy, whale hunting co-author, takes the delivery of value a great leap further with a formula to quickly penetrate markets. His approach is to conduct TV news-style interviews of a dozen thought leaders in a given market. The interviews are transcribed into a book and the videos shared with each executive's company. This makes it easy to penetrate any company simply by calling its PR department and offering to do it all at no cost. The approach allows Searcy to deliver an overwhelming amount of value to the targeted executives, leading to lasting contact and valuable relationships in a newly conquered market. Your next step. Consider if any of these will work with any of your prospective clients. If so, schedule some time on your calendar for reading articles, thinking through the best candidates for your advisory group, or planning an interview. Consistently delivering value is the best way to employ the power of perseverance in your contact marketing efforts. It's the difference between being a pest and generating startling new levels of business. If you're continuing to ping your prospects with the message, "Hey, I was just checking in to see if anything changed," you're wasting their time and yours. But if your messages change to, "I thought you might find the transcripts from last week's Gartner conference useful," you may quickly earn a chance to do business. How the contact sees you has changed, and the new perception works in your favor. Contact marketing is intended to shorten the cycle of making critical connections happen. Whether you break through right away, or it takes several tries, you're just beginning a journey toward a relationship meant to last and help your clients improve their businesses. It's a long-term process, and it should always be fueled by the exchange of value and insights. Serving final notice. We've all experienced stalled proposals. You've had several conversations with the client. They love what you've been telling them, and you eagerly await sign-off on your proposal, which you're assured is in the works. Then, nothing. Crickets. You know you need to break the silence and get the ball rolling again if you ever hope to get the business. But what if you've exhausted your personal limit of follow-up calls or your persistence process has run its course? At this point, many would be ready to give up and move on. They'd sigh and think, "Well, it wasn't meant to be." I know how you feel. It can be a time of peak frustration. But for me, it's actually one of the most enjoyable stages of a campaign. How can that be? Because now, we get to unleash the mischief, to serve notice that it's all about to end, that they're about to miss out. Ultimate Sales Machine author Chet Holmes once shared a wonderfully devilish method for getting people to finally respond. His tool of choice was a miniature trash can stuffed with a wadded-up copy of his final contact letter. The letter started by saying, "I've sent you several letters in the past to which you never have replied. Since I assume you must have thrown those all in the trash, I thought I'd save you some time with this one." My old friend Chet was using a classic contact marketing visual metaphor to get his point across, that the recipient's lack of response had been quite rude. He took a risk with this approach, sure, but these packages were going to potential clients who weren't responding. He knew he had to do something, or they'd drift away forever. Another favorite method of serving final notice is one of my own. I explain it in the next case study. Case study: a beautiful giclée art print for their office. Background: proposals stall all the time. They probably stall far more often than they succeed, leaving us all at some point to wonder what to do next. What we need is a foolproof method to restore momentum. Challenges: if you've had proposals stall, your prospects have probably had other priorities pop up, displacing your proposal from their immediate focus. Or they've lost interest. Or they haven't noticed they're delaying anything. Whatever the reason, saving the proposed sale requires immediate action. Campaign specifics: my solution is to have a fine art giclée print made up, featuring the cartoon at the beginning of this book. It shows an executive with his sleeves rolled up and the phone cradled on his shoulders as he leafs through some papers on his desk. The caption: hey, listen, we got your proposal and like everything except having to pay you. The print is packaged in my own custom fold-over folio piece, made of corrugated cardboard covered with enlarged mezzotint cartoon art. Inside is a handwritten note saying, "Sorry it didn't work out this time. Maybe next time." The reactions are often priceless. Results: the giclée print piece, combined with the handwritten note, immediately prompts recipients to pick up the phone or reach out by email, restoring forward motion to roughly 50% of the stalled proposals. They often call to apologize for the delay and immediately approve the proposed project. Key takeaway: the people I'm reaching out to have not been responding to my proposal or follow-ups. I need an effective means to reach them, and creativity helps. Sometimes prospects aren't actively avoiding your call, but have fallen into a rut. They're embarrassed that they haven't called you, and the longer it goes, the deeper their embarrassment. The serving final notice, humorous contact piece, interrupts all of that. Variation: I have other cartoons at my disposal that I send as greeting cards to prospective clients to prompt replies. One that I've used frequently shows a guy standing at a payphone at an old broken-down gas station in the middle of the desert, probably somewhere along Route 66. He's speaking into the phone, saying, "Hi, Bob, it's me again. Listen, I don't know if you've been checking your voicemail all last week, but I'm still here at the same number, waiting for your call." Of course, with the name Bob in the caption, I'm sending it to someone named Bob. Chances are, if Bob has not been answering my calls, he will now. I find these kinds of campaigns to be quite valuable. While they may seem a bit silly, they are also utterly disarming. Who wouldn't crack when presented with a tiny trash can with a final contact letter wadded up inside? It takes a lot of nerve to send a letter that way, but what do you have to lose? Remember, these campaigns are going to people who have not been responding. They will probably be gone forever without some forceful intervention. Set an expiration date. When a persistence campaign nears the end of its tether, you have a few choices. Letting it lapse seems like a waste of a lot of invested effort. Serving a final notice can be effective. There's also a third option: invoke an expiration date. Sales thought leader and author Tibor Shanto says it's a basic law of human behavior. People want what they cannot have. Putting an expiration date on a proposal makes use of that law. If prospective clients have a serious interest in your service or product, a deadline can cause them to act as they become aware of the closing window of opportunity. Advertisers bank on this principle all the time, and effective sales representatives build it into their strategies for closing deals as well. Case study. This is about to expire. Background. Despite our best attempts to woo them, clients sometimes don't take action on our proposals. Gaining leverage in those situations can be difficult, so you need to let the dynamics of human behavior work in your favor. Entice people to go after what they cannot have. Challenges. There is a risk that an expiration date might backfire, but Shanto feels the rewards far exceed the risks. If the prospect doesn't like the idea of a deadline imposed by a vendor, Shanto reasons, then they're not a serious prospect. It's best to know that early. Campaign specifics. Sales tactician Tibor Shanto gets people's attention with deadlines. If a prospect knows that she must make a decision within a given time frame, she's more apt to respond. Shanto employs this tactic in various ways, but the most common is putting it in writing at the pitch stage. When Shanto formulates a proposal to a prospective client, he simply adds an expiration date and time. For example,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Playbooks, use the link in the video description.